Hello, and welcome to the Know It Some podcast. I'm your host, Steve Platt. Each week, you're going to hear a new episode from a guest who has a different background, walk of life, different life experiences, and stories that they can share from a perspective that perhaps you haven't heard before. And the whole point is, we're going to become more well-rounded, learn something each week. After all, no one likes to know it all, but it's always good to know it some. This week's guest is Ted Davis. Ted is a photographer. Really, he's a travel photographer, does landscapes, he does wildlife. His imagery is incredible. You're going to be able to find that at teddavisphoto.com, Ted Davis Photo on Instagram. On top of that, he's a founding partner of Horizon Ventures. He helps many businesses grow and succeed. And in that role, he's also president of Plant House, which he discusses with us a little bit. They're expanding across the Eastern Seaboard, and it's more than just a store. It's a really cool concept. It's an experience. Check that out. Check out Plant House. But I really enjoyed my interview with Ted. He's a great guy, great friend of mine. His imagery is phenomenal. Follow him on Instagram. Check him out on his website. I have like three or four Ted Davis pieces now in my home, in my office. Just phenomenal work. So definitely check that out, guys. Without further ado, let's get to the interview. Please welcome our guest, Ted Davis.
Ed.
What's going on?
Not much, man. How are you doing?
Good. Surviving the week, surviving the quarter, I guess. We're into Q2, so made it.
I don't know how you balance everything that you do.
I honestly don't know at this point either.
Oh, man. Well, I appreciate you coming on. There's a lot that that you do that would surprise most people who only have a passing knowledge of the stuff you dabble in.
Sure.
So, you know, right now you're you have Plant Bar, right? And and ADT, right?
We actually sold ADT.
Sold.
Yep.
Gone. All right.
Well, yeah.
Congratulations.
Yeah, it was our first. I'm not gonna say big, but it was our first pretty large exit. So that was exciting for us.
Nice. But how I first got to know you, right, was as a photographer, which, you know, whether you want to, you know, brag about it or not, because I know you're a pretty humble guy, it is definitely one of your greatest strengths, right? And it's how I first met you. And, you know, for the listeners of this podcast, you know, I will confess that I have two pieces in my house, wonderful Ted Davis photographs in my house, and hope to get more
large ones. Yeah.
Yes. Large ones. I think one's like a 60 inch or something like that.
Yeah.
Yeah. So talk to me, how did you get into photography? Like, what was your first exposure growing up to photography in general? How did that start to interest you?
Oh man. I'd say, you know, from early on, you know, getting outside. I grew up in, you know, in the Adirondacks, basically in New York. So for us, it was outside every day. I mean, I got in trouble as a kid quite frequently, just for you know, boy stuff. I'd say, kid yeah. stuff. I remember one time we actually wanted to see if we could redirect the creek in our neighborhood, like beavers do. So we built a dam. That to our chagrin was very well constructed and did divert the creek and cause some neighborhood issues. So always outdoors growing up, I guess.
You're a trendsetter, the everlast or whatever.
You know, green. You read about these stories or hear about these stories about, you know, kids getting into mischief. That was definitely me and my friends growing up. But always outside, always exploring the mountains, loved being outside, loved, you know, going to camp during the summer and hiking and camping out. And, you know, I started probably bringing my camera with me when I was 13, 14, 15, something like that. It, you know, obviously wasn't mine. It was my dad's camera. And, you know, shooting photography, took a class in high school just as an elective because I need another art class. And, actually, I didn't really pick it back up until I was in law school, and started doing that. Spent some time in Europe, going around, and just loved the opportunity of photographing, you know, the old style homes and castles and the artwork there. And it became my release, my outlet when I moved to New York City, you know, working at my firm after law school.
Yeah, I was about to say, you gloss over that. You're like, you know, after law school, not a lot of photographers are actually attorneys, right? But you went to law school, graduated law school, and you were practicing law, you said, in New York. And you were able to leave that kind of a profession, right, which a lot of people would say is you know, a very notable profession, right, one that can bring great things to one's life. You were able to leave that for this passion of photography. Talk to me a little bit about that.
I was at an inflection point at the firm. We were doing really good work. Got some great feedback from mentors and my boss there, and other project leads on different engagements. And basically, I was on the path to get promoted, basically in the first kind of tier of promotions that I could be up to the, you know, up to the next level. And I kind of took a hard look and said, hey, is this what I want to be doing for the rest of this life? Because once you get promoted past that initial kind of level in a firm, and so
there's no turning back.
Yeah. And I was in a consulting firm. We did the consultative work. We weren't an actual law firm. So we did a lot of financial analysis, based on, you know, companies, you know, government sector, things like that. So I was basically getting put in charge of a team as a manager there. And I had the decision to make: is this what I want to do for the rest of my life? Or at least a good portion of it, great money, staying in New York, et cetera. Or do I want to give it a go, so to speak, and test my hand at photography, building a business, you know, chasing the dream, all of that people talk about. And I basically got to the point where it was, you know, do or die. And I said, you know what? I was young. I graduated high school young, college young, law school young, and I was only in the position for a couple of years. And I said, you know what? If I'm going to take a chance, it's now, because it definitely right. is not going to be after I get this pay raise. And the right. expectations kind of go up again. So
you took a leap of faith.
Yeah. And I was good on loans and debt. I saved a lot of money my first couple of years. You're working so hard at firms like that in New York that you don't really have a lot of stuff. You don't have time to spend the money. So right. I was able to, you know, kind of get smart with my finances. I've never been, you know, a big spender by any means. Extravagant. So, you know, I got my, you know, once I realized that this was the route I was going to do, I took about 6 months, got everything straightened away, and took this leap. And I left. I gave my notice July, I want to say like it was July 2nd, or excuse me, I gave my notice in June, and my last day of work was July 2nd, and had a big July 4th celebration over that weekend. And
that's awesome.
That was it. I was gone from New York City a month later, moved down to North Carolina, and, you know, became almost a semi-nomad for about a year, trying to figure it out as I went.
Well, you know, that nomadic nature, I don't think has ever left you, because you have a love for travel and you've been able to kind of intertwine travel with your photography. I've noticed that, you know, your travels kind of take you everywhere, because you don't just do cityscapes, but you do wildlife, you do nature, you do landscapes, you know, I mean, you do everything. It seems like there's a bit of variety there, because you have stuff from Southeast Asia and from Iceland and you know, from Africa, and it's all remarkable. Like, you're able to do so many different things. Well, was that always kind of the goal, to have a little bit of a broad spectrum there, to be able to travel? I mean, or did that just kind of evolve?
Oh gosh, no. I'd say it started pure landscapes. Like, I love getting out and camping. I love, you know, going out hiking, you know, whether it's snowshoeing or climbing over glaciers or, you know, in the water. And as you said, Southeast Asia or Hawaii or, you know, off the coast of California, whatever it may be. Like for me, the outdoors drew me. And, you know, one of the things you learn as an entrepreneur, and anyone will tell you this, that, you know, you have to listen to your customer base. You can't fall in love with your product if your customer doesn't want it, because what are you doing?
Then it's a hobby.
Yeah, and then it's more of just what you want to do, not what your customer needs. So me trying to afford life, you know, food and shelter and water, I needed to listen to my customers are asking, and they wanted me to take my landscape skills and apply them to places they've been. So Rome and Florence and Paris, and off the coast of Normandy and, you know, Southern Spain and all of that. And so I said, you know what? I think it was 2016. I didn't have a lot of money saved up. You know, I'd gone through savings. I'd been living this life for about 2 years. So I was quote unquote making it. But you know, you can't just throw down 10 grand on a trip to Europe. So I had a little bit of a Kickstarter and I went and, you know, did Italy, just Italy, central Italy for 4 weeks, stayed in hostels, rented a crappy little car, ate, you know, cheap, didn't drink, you know, just being very minimalist, and came back with some great photos and kind of established myself as a travel photographer at that point. And then from there is, oh my gosh, I love your Italy. You know, can you do France? Okay. You know, I went to Paris, went to Southern France, did the lavender fields. Okay. How about Greece? We love Santorini. All right. Well, let, you know, twist my arm, why don't you? And, you know, send me to Santorini for a week.
But your photos are kind of unique though, because although a lot of those are high demand locations and maybe can, you know, the photos from there can all kind of look the same and be cliche, you put a unique twist on yours. I know specifically, you know, in France, for instance, Notre Dame, you took it from a completely different angle than most people approach that, right?
Yeah. And you know, that kind of comes from the landscape, I guess, background that I built myself off of. It was, you know, you want to, it's the same scene, but you want your take. It's got to be your art.
Yep.
And so for me, there are some classic shots that are just so unbelievable, so beautiful, you want to take. And even if you don't sell them as an artist or as a photographer, you want to have them and say you did it. But yeah, like Notre Dame, you know, I went on, you know, a very high tide. I planned, you know, planned my trip out so that high tide coincided with sunset. That's when I planned to be in Paris for about three to four days. I ended up being there. And I said, you know what, I'm going to take this from the back and, you know, back of the cathedral from a bridge. And, you know, I was there three nights in a row and I got a great sunset the last night. And, you know, that's my take on Notre Dame, a little bit different, you know, with the bell towers and obviously what happened there, you know, the past couple of years is just really terrible.
It is. It's tragic. It's heartbreaking, but you know, the shots like that, it's amazing the preparation that go into it. You know, you having to plan the high tide coinciding with where the sun's going to be. Like a lot of folks, when they purchase artwork, if they're new to purchasing artwork and new to purchasing photography, right? They might not know how much preparation goes into these shots and how much planning goes into these shots and that kind of thing. But then as they go along and you start collecting, I think you start realizing that every photograph has a story. And, you know, I'm sure you share those stories with the folks that are looking at your photography and looking to purchase. When you buy a Ted Davis photo, you know, what goes into that kind of a conversation and learning the story behind it?
Yeah, so you know, I'm a firm believer in that, you know, that at first you've got to get drawn to a piece. So, you know, someone's drawn to a piece, whether that's an art show to exhibit online, typically, you know, they'll reach out or, you know, we'll initiate that conversation and, like, man, like that's beautiful. Where is it? Right. That's the first question. Where is it? What is that? What is this real? Like, does this exist? And from there, you kind of, I don't want to say you're educating, you know, the your potential buyer. But that kind of is what it is. You're kind of explaining kind of your own individual process behind something, and then you're trying to give a little bit of detail about where it is, and yes, this exists. And for me, I love it when, you know, it's a family and it's a husband or wife, maybe with a kid or two, and they come in and they're talking about a shot. And you know, I always, especially with some of the more landscape type images, you know, I always like to tell the kid, be like, hey, if they like it, they say something about it. Like, you know, that place really exists out there. Like, none of this is fake. This isn't, you know, the TV. This isn't CG. Like, this you can explore this. You can see this yourself. You know, that's an option. That's an opportunity for you. And the kids, I mean, their eyes like light, like, really? Like, yeah, you know, that's in, you know, Africa, or that's in, you know, Southeast Asia. Like, those ruins really exist. They're finding new ones every day in Siem Reap and, you know, Cambodia. For me, that was fascinating, actually. I had no idea that, you know, they're still excavating, and they don't even think they've uncovered half of the Angkor Wat entire complex, which is just amazing and, you know, just unbelievable. So there's still so much more to explore and see in the world, that there's always going to be opportunity for photographers to go out and capture that and bring that beauty back.
Absolutely. And then assuming that you are able to hit these destinations, right? And you know, let's say you know everything there is to know about photography, you're able to frame it right, the lighting's good, you know, exposure, everything, you got it all down, and you bring that photograph back, then there's a whole other side of it, because then you have to know what you're doing in terms of editing to clean up shadows and play with the highlights and the lowlights and the contrast. And did it take some time to develop skills in that area, in terms of editing these photographs once you return from a trip?
Absolutely. There's a level of familiarity you have to have with, whether it's Lightroom or Photoshop. Those are, you know, they're top two for photographers to use. And I would say the first couple years for me, it's akin to finding your own voice, whether it's, you know, a writer or a singer or an artist. It's finding your style. And there, no one can teach you that. You know, there are ways you can emulate other photographers you look up to, you know, people who are, whether they're famous or not, or whatever, you know, something that appeals to you. And then you learn your own style. I have a minimalist style, but that does have a very large dynamic range. So I do shoot most of my landscapes, actually all my landscapes, on what's called a medium format camera. So it's naturally more dynamic in range. That means you're getting more highlights and shadows into the image initially. And that's what it makes, you know, that's what brings it to life. These, you know, world famous photographers out there, they're using the same cameras, and that's some of the reason why. You know, you be in the right spot, you get lucky with the lighting, you know, sunset, sunrise, shadows playing right on it. You know, maybe it's under construction, maybe it's not. And then it comes down to, you know, some of the equipment you're using. And once you come back, you got to develop that. And you know, whether you want to go hard on editing or have a lighter touch, everyone develops their own style, their own voice. And then you have to produce it. A lot of people don't realize what you actually print on has a massive impact on the feel.
Like the actual
Yeah,
medium
exactly.
that is being delivered. So, I noticed you know, you have canvas, right? You have metallic prints. You have like this acrylic glass. I'm lucky enough to have both canvas, metallic, and acrylic, thanks to you, in my home in different areas. You know, depending on the theme and mood of the room and how much lighting's coming into the room, it can make a big difference, right? Do you have a particular favorite, or does it depend on the image?
So, I would say I have a favorite. So if everything, you know, everything's equal, in terms of lighting in a room, things like that, I prefer the acrylic. It's very, very sharp, great colors. That acrylic glass, that quarter inch glass on front of the image, it's actually attached on front of the image. adds a dimension of depth. So that the way you print it, that can bring in more dimension into an image that can be flatter if it's printed on metal or paper or canvas. That being said, depending on the lighting in the room, if you have a lot of natural light in a room that the light is actually hitting on the image, just like a television, hitting on the television or reflecting off of it, you're going to want to go with a canvas or non-glare. Because the whole point of having a piece of artwork in the home is to be able to appreciate it. Well, if it's constantly has a glare on it or light on it, and you can't see it, well, it doesn't matter if it's a beautiful acrylic or not, you can't see the image. So that's the one big consideration where I'll point my client towards, if it's economically viable, the acrylic, or let's go with it with a canvas piece, and maybe we do, like a shadow frame box around it where it's not a super extravagant frame, but it is enough to finish the image.
And you know what's amazing about that acrylic, I have the non-glare acrylic in the living room, is it makes the image pop without having to be this cartoonish almost, like, you know, you say you're a minimalist, right? Some of these other artists, and photographers will just way overdo it on the editing, and the way that they play with highlights and contrast and everything just gives it an unnatural look. Whereas when I look at your photos, it's like I'm there. Like if we're talking about on safari and it's a wildlife photo, I mean, it's really like being there. Which probably took you some time, because that's a fine line.
Yeah, absolutely. And I would definitely say I was on the more, I over edited in the beginning of my career. I thought it was, yeah, it's
Because
fun.
it's
I
fun.
thought it was necessary to sell, and then as you, again, as you find your voice and you get better at it, you realize, you know what, if I have the shot, doesn't really matter. The editing, it does, but for the
You clean
most
it up a
part,
little,
you
but
have the shot and you just need to, it's there, just find it. While early on, you might not have the shot and you try to create it
so you're like, I'm
exactly.
gonna create it.
And you just gotta stay away from that and allow like the natural image to come through. And that's what you're accentuating. You're trying to bring that to life so that people feel like you feel when you look at your images, which is, I'm there. You want to transport someone.
Now, you know, you don't just take photos and sell photos. What I've noticed is that you've found the time and the patience to teach others who are interested in getting into photography and learning about how to take these photos and edit photos, and so you developed, you know, a second business surrounding photography where it focused more on workshops and destination workshops at that. Could you talk a little
Yeah,
bit about that?
so this is a little bit, this is funny. I gosh, this was probably at a show in Sarasota, actually. I think one of the sh I think it may have been either the show I actually met you, Steve, or a different one, but it was in St. Armand's, and I was across Kitty Corner, Catty Corner from another photographer. It's an entirely different type of photography. No competition. Great woman. Very, very fun to talk to. Well, her mother was there and came in my booth and loved it. Also an artist, different medium, but basically, asked me if I did this because she'd love to tag along and maybe her daughter would as well. Just it's something else, something different. And I said, I don't know about the teaching thing. Do I have the patience for it? Is that really something I want to do? I don't know. And she's like, you'll never know until you try it. I was like, maybe I'll give it a shot. What's a place I know very well? Well, I started traveling to Italy when I was 8 years old. I studied there, actually painting and drawing, outside Florence. And so I said, you know what? I know Italy pretty well. Why don't I give this a shot? do it kind of as a ch cheaper option than some of these other tours. You call them photography workshops, if you will. And let's
Right.
see. And my art speaks for itself, I believe. So maybe someone will say, you know what, I want to take images like Ted takes images, and he knows where to go. So I put a ridiculous amount of time into planning out this trip, every little detail. I mean, I had plan A through E on what would happen if things went wrong. The lighting was poor. What if a hotel didn't have the, all everything, because I was super paranoid that
Right.
I was going to mess this up for people.
Because there's unknown
Absolutely. And
variables that are going to
there
pop up.
always are.
Yeah.
So, plan the best, and then you won't be anxious about things, and it'll just happen, and you'll know if something goes wrong, hey, I already thought of a plan B. And we did go down some plan B routes on this trip, but ended up being a great success. I actually thoroughly enjoyed the teaching aspect. What I didn't realize at the time was I loved taking the photos, coming back home, and selling them to people, because I wanted them to experience what I experienced when I was there on the image. And what I didn't do, I didn't connect the
Absolutely.
dots at the time, was I can literally bring them there to experience what I experienced on
Right.
site, and give them
That's
that
awesome.
true experience. And that's what I was able to do with this first workshop in Italy. And since then, done southern France, done Iceland a few times, three, four, five times, Italy again, Africa twice, actually. Love the wildlife. Actually, three times, actually, twice in Namibia, once in Kenya. And what I realized is I love doing that. Unfortunately, the pandemic canceled, two of my workshops last year.
I'm sorry.
Once things get a little bit better, a little bit safer, we probably looking at, 2022, restarting those and getting back to Italy and Iceland and Africa, and kind of bringing the experience to folks again.
I mean, you're taking people all over the place and you're doing the research ahead of time, on these locations. What kind of When it comes to, all inclusive, meaning, finding a place to stay or a place to eat and so on and so forth, what kind of an experience can people expect should they
Yeah,
book a workshop
so
with you?
it's going to be very similar for, I'd say, everywhere except for Iceland. And the reason I say that, Iceland, it's you're chasing, lots of times you're chasing the northern lights. My workshops typically go in, February, March, or August, September, those time frames, where we are chasing the northern lights. So the package is going to be a little bit cheaper, but you have to pay for your own food, because I have no idea where we're going to stop, what we're going to do, anything like that. So we kind of pull that out. For the rest of them, they're pretty much all inclusive. Restaurants I've been to, people I know, accommodations I've stayed at before. I won't ever take a workshop to a place that I have not personally been to and photographed and know. In Italy, which is my most popular one by far, although Iceland's a close second, we have a driver in a van, and he takes us everywhere. And he's a guy I've now known for 4 or 5 years. I know his wife. I've stayed at their house before. We do cooking classes with some of their friends. And so it's
Nice.
that that's it's the experience of it. It's not just photography. And I know some experiences
It's
are
immersive.
just photography, but I try to bring in the culture and the people and the whole experience of the
That's
place we're
awesome.
visiting, because that's what you, at the end of the day, you remember. I mean, we did the first trip in Italy. The complaint I had was that it took me about 2 weeks to get the recipes from the cooking class we did. To my, I had no idea that they were going to love it so much and that they want the recipes, and then ended up
Right.
being such a phenomenal experience for them.
Well, there's no better way to travel because you have your travel agent is also your tour guide and your photography teacher. You know what I mean? Like, it's an all in one kind of a deal and a fully immersive experience where you are able to, I think, get the broadest taste of
And
the place that you're
you know,
visiting.
we I go with a maximum of six people. I've never actually had six. Most I've brought is five. Typically it's four to five. And we've called audibles before, you know, we'll be like, hey guys, we've done this and we nailed this shot. We're still scheduled for like another day to try to capture this. Everyone feel comfortable? Did everyone get their shot that they wanted? Yes, or you did? Okay, cool. I know another place that you know, is a second or third tier, but it's cool, you know, it's different. Let's go there instead for a sunset or for an afternoon shoot because it's the right timing. And you know, then now we're gonna change
That's
restaurants and it's
awesome.
okay because I know a different place because I've been there before. And
So you're not on a
right.
tour bus with 30 something people, you know what I mean? Going just museum hopping. You're actually getting to
Yeah.
experience
And
the
I mean,
place that
we
you're visiting.
go as hard and as long as people want. Each of my trips, you know, there are optional mornings that we have. You know, typically by the fifth day, it's pretty tiring. We're trying to get as a lot in. And you know, so we have some mornings where it's a very easy shoot. Just walk out your door in your small hotel. And you know, photograph the sunrise over the sweeping hills or whatever it may be. But there's an option to also go for a 2 mile hike in the morning and photograph something else. Which typically I'll have one or two people do that the first day. And then, you know, by the third, fourth, fifth day, you know, it is a lot going on. There's really the option to sleep in a little bit, get, you know, more of a 7, 8 hours of sleep, and then wake up and feel kind of revitalized. So, you know, for me, I don't know whether it's just pure adrenaline or anxiety that just rolls through my body, to make sure this is a great experience, but I'm always ready to go. And there's so much to teach and to show folks. I get so excited. I will say once that trip ends, I typically stay in country for another day or two. And that day after, I'm pretty much a zombie. Sleep for probably about 14, 16 hours. But then get back to it.
That's awesome. You know, your photography, sometimes I see it and I go, man, that's beautiful. It looks like a Thomas Kincaid puzzle. And then now I see that your photography is now actually on puzzles and other things. Like you're able to make some deals now, where more people are seeing your photography.
Yeah, we've
That's got to be
got
kind of cool for you.
I have an agent. She's great, Susan. She's been helping a lot with this. She basically markets my work. I've got, gosh, one puzzle company. They're normal puzzles, I guess. And you know, I think they've got 14 or 16 coming out this year. And then we have Nautilus puzzles, which are pretty cool because they are, I would probably say, a much higher end puzzle. And what they do is, you know, they take the scene and their puzzle pieces are based off of the theme of the photo. So, you know, for one that maybe has a lot of tulips in it, like the pieces will be leaves and tulips, and maybe a windmill and things like that, to where it's a lot more, I guess, a dynamic puzzle. They're thicker, they're really fun. They sent me I have a few puzzles that they're doing. I think they've released two of mine so far. We have a few more coming. I'm not a big puzzle person, so I'm not sure how difficult they should be. They're fairly difficult for me.
I happen to love puzzles, so
Yeah.
I'll keep an eye out for them. If someone's interested in purchasing your photography, which I highly encourage people to check out because it's going to transform your home or your office if you bring one home. Where can they
Sure.
find
So
your artwork?
online, it's easy. It's just teddavisphoto.com. You know, I have my galleries there. You know, updating through the pandemic. I don't have like a newest releases gallery really anymore. It's more of a favorites gallery. But I try to arrange things through scenes, not through the most recent uploads. So if you're, you know, looking for a beach
Okay.
scene, there's a seascapes area. If you're looking for you know, Rome or Italy, there's an Italy gallery that has most of my Italy portfolio in there. And then if you're looking for like forests, plains, rivers, things like that, you can find it based on your scene. Now, obviously, you can just, you know, view them all and go through
Okay.
all of them. The most popular
Gotcha.
sizes are definitely those 1x3s, those what, you know, what we call panoramics. They sit perfectly above a couch, above a TV if you have tall walls, things like that. Beds, nightstands, night tables, dressers, things like that, are where, you know, we kind of find a lot of those. Those are the most popular. I do have more, I'd say, vertical landscapes than most landscape photographers. Landscape photography is actually difficult, more difficult to shoot vertically than it is horizontally. Just, you know, the nature of
Absolutely.
a landscape. But I actually have some pretty cool
Yeah.
verticals that I actually have in my home, as well, just 'cause.
I have
Yeah,
one as
exactly.
well, the waterfall
So,
from Hawaii.
you know, I actually have a larger selection of verticals that may fit, you know, certain homes and themes better. Yeah.
That's awesome. That's okay. And then is there a different website for the workshops? Because I know right now with the pandemic, aren't any workshops going on, but post-pandemic, should that ever become a thing, somebody might be listening to this podcast in the future, going back over older episodes, and get interested in traveling with you. So for those of you who love travel and
Yeah, so
photography,
I believe you can
where
still
do they go?
access it through teddavisphoto.com. I think there's a link there to go to it, but it's Vistas Revealed. And yeah,
Okay.
that'll get updated. I
Awesome.
mean, we probably update that once a year. And that's just with, you know, kind of the upcoming workshops. It's dated. I haven't updated that since the pandemic. Yeah, but what I do
Understood.
like to, I do
Acceptable.
like to leave up older workshops that we've done in the past so that people can see what other options there are. And you know, if there's two or three people in a group, maybe even two couples who are interested in a certain area of the world or a certain type of workshop or have a time frame they're thinking of, I have done custom workshops where I will literally go a year or 6 months ahead of time, scout out everything, do the trip on my own dime, capture some images to hopefully come back and sell, build out a workshop, and then basically sell it. And I've had groups of people do that. So I had a group of three people really want to go to Kenya. I'd never been before. So I said, you know what? Let me plan out a trip myself. I'll go there. I'll spend a week. I'll scout everything. I'll go to two to three different lodges. Typically, you go to one. Said, you know what? Let me go to a few different ones. Let me see some different game reserves. Let me see the Maasai and go to a couple of these villages and talk to them. And I was able to do all that and then came back and said, hey, you know, it's going to be a little bit more expensive, but I've now been there myself. I know exactly where to go. I know who to talk to. And we were able to get photos of all the big five. And then we were able to get, you know, some baby cheetahs, some baby lions. Some hunts and things like that, because I was able to go and talk to folks and meet them in the field. And so, you know,
Yeah, those are some stunning
just got,
shots. I
I
mean, really
mean,
incredible shots of
wildlife,
wildlife.
you get lucky. You put yourself in the spot to succeed, and then you just hope and wait. So, yeah.
That's
Go ahead.
phenomenal. And then, sorry. No, I was just gonna say, that covers how they could find your photography and then how they can book a trip once that's up and running in the future. What if they want to hear some of the stories behind the photo that they're buying and stuff like that? Where can folks
I'm
find you
at
on social
Ted
media?
Davis Photo. That's Instagram. Don't really, I do have a Facebook page also at Ted Davis Photo. They can find me there.
Phenomenal.
Instagram is probably where you can see a little bit more of my portfolio. it does have a lot of photos that I do not have not released. It doesn't mean I won't release them or won't sell them. It's just I'm very picky. I try to, unlike other artists, there's nothing wrong with this. I select, if I have a slew of images, I select one, maybe two, and I'll produce those two, get them on the website, get them up to sell. But that doesn't mean that the other ones are unavailable. It just means that on the website, they're not there. But Instagram, yeah, I mean, I have a whole, an entire black and white wildlife photo portfolio on Instagram that, you know, isn't even on the website. So I love it.
Wow. Check it out, folks. It's worth looking into, guys. It's some amazing shots. So before I let you go, I'd like to let you plug anything you got coming up. I know that Plant Bar, talk a little bit about Plant Bar. I know you got some openings and stuff. But really this is an opportunity for you to
Sure.
get out
So,
anything you need to
you
get out.
know, I Steve, you've known me for a while now. Before, you know, we started, what my business partner Nate and I started was Horizon Ventures. You know, we do venture investing, business consulting, through my, gosh, I don't know, half a decade, 6 years, 7 years now, I guess, of building companies and you know, both, you know, family businesses. Working in New York and then, you know, building a photography business, a workshop business, you know, having a business start and fail in North Carolina. So, you know, we do investing in that. We have Plant House now. We just rebranded actually. Yeah, so that's a big move for us. It
Oh,
took us a
wow.
little
Okay.
while, but we are officially Plant House now. And we do we're a
Awesome.
terrarium workshop and plant store. So it's an experiential-based plant store that we want people to come in and have just a great experience. You can build a terrarium, macrame, kokedama, have a glass of wine, a beer. We do have a beer and wine license, and we're located, you know, all over the eastern seaboard at this point. You know, we have stores already in Virginia, North Carolina. I've recently signed leases for our company. In South Carolina and Georgia and in Florida. So, you know, probably news for you, Steve, but in the last week we're going to be
Phenomenal.
opening up something here near you. So fully expect you to come up once we have that grand opening.
That's awesome. Absolutely. Where can
Yeah,
people find you online, find the
planthouse.us.
nearest location for them?
Pretty simple to remember. It's, you know, pretty minimalist website. Go in there, click on locations. You can kind of find your nearest locations. You know, during the pandemic, a lot of people found plants to be reassuring, wanted to grow plants. They're at home a lot. Great for the office, for you know, your lifestyle and for your home. And so yeah, we're trying to expand and bring that experience to people all up and down the eastern seaboard. So you know, we'll pretty much the southeast from Virginia down to Florida here in the next couple of years.
That's awesome. And you know, on the business venture front, and when it comes to venture capital or business consulting, I mean, that's the kind of stuff that people are looking for. Is there's a need, right? Like you said, you know, people found that to be comforting during the pandemic, and you're able to meet that need, right? Seize on opportunities like that. Anybody that's considering, you know, looking for some venture capital or some business consulting, definitely should reach out as well and get in touch with you. I'm gonna have Nate on the podcast eventually to talk about his story and a little bit more about Horizon. But that's awesome, man. I really appreciate you coming on. Very, very excited about the things ahead for you.
Yeah,
And
absolutely,
it means
Steve.
a lot
Thanks
to you taking
for
time to
having
speak
me,
with
for
us today.
inviting me on the podcast. Definitely want to check out some of these other episodes you have. You know, I've seen a couple of them now. I think you posted on Facebook, and so I've bookmarked them to catch up to over the weekend here when I'm driving from place to place. So can't wait to see where you go with this.
Yeah, no, it's an exciting concept. I mean, the whole idea centers around the fact that we can learn from other people, right? Because everybody's got different experiences and perspectives. And so, you know, I named it the Know It Some podcast because nobody likes to know it all, but it's always good to know it some and be, you know, well-rounded. I feel like the concept got a bad rap with the whole, you know, jack of all trades, master of none thing. So everybody wants to be in their niche and they want to specialize and become experts. And there's nothing wrong with that. But to not have any idea of what goes on outside your own life and your own little niche or bubble, it can be a bad thing too, because I think all extremes can be bad, right? So the idea of this podcast is, you know, once a week, every Tuesday, we're going to release an episode, and there's going to be a broad spectrum of guests. And I think it helps keep people, you know, well-rounded. They know a little bit about.
Well, I can tell you, I mean, we're hiring at Plant House. We're building our corporate team. I hired someone about 3 weeks ago. He is everything we wanted and needed and more. He has about 3 years of experience out of college. And what I didn't want was I didn't want someone siloed in the role that we're looking for. I needed someone with a little bit of experience and willingness to work through the system, because we're a young, small company. And, you know, sometimes we're going to have situations outside your job description that need to get handled because there just is no one else there to handle it. I would much rather hire someone who has a varied experience, a jack of all trades, so to speak, and then teach them our process for what they're doing, while maintaining and elevating the rest of their other trades, giving that experience elsewhere in the company, whether it's on the financial side, whether it's on the training side, the managing of people side, whatever it may be. You know, businesses are, they want a specialist, but they want a well-experienced specialist. So don't get pigeonholed into doing one thing, you know, because I'll tell you, I want those people who have experienced a bunch and have life experiences outside of just the role, because we can teach you what the role needs. We can't teach you that varied experience.
Absolutely. And that's the mission here. We're going to, I mean, we're the jack of all trades kind of a podcast. So definitely excited about this episode coming out. I appreciate
all right, Steve,
your
thanks
time,
so much.
And hopefully have you on again someday.
And that'll do it for another episode of the Know It Some podcast. My thanks again to Ted Davis. Please check him out. Ted Davis Photo on Instagram. TedDavisPhoto.com is his website. Incredible images there to go look at. And also check out Plant House, folks. Coming to a city near you, I am sure of it. And for those of you who have already left us rankings and reviews on Apple, who have already subscribed or shared our social media posts, liked us on social media, thank you so much. You can find us at Know It Some Pod. That's Know It Some Pod on Twitter, Know It Some Pod on Instagram. Make sure that you check us out, like us, share us. This organic growth has allowed us to book some really cool guests going forward. I have some amazing folks who have already committed and set their interview up with us. I'm very excited to share those interviews with you when the time comes. A new episode every week on Tuesday. Until next week, thanks for listening, folks. This has been the Know It Some podcast. I'm your host, Steve Platt, and I'll see you next week. Take care.